Good morning. I think we are back. Hopefully you can hear us at home. It's wonderful to be gathering this morning to worship. Thank you so much for bearing with us. We've been having some technical difficulties this morning, as you've probably gathered, but we think we're there. Thank you for your patience and for praying with us as we've attempted to kind of get to grips with that. We are going to carry on. Well, I'll tell you what, I think you haven't had sound from the beginning, so we're going to begin again from the start of the service. It's great to gather to be here. Welcome for a second time to our service of online worship. It's great to be here, even if we're gathering from home and persevering with technical difficulties. The Lord is here, His Holy Spirit is present, and we can still worship. You can probably see there are a few of us here this morning, quite a number in the worship band, and just some amazing team of technical guys at the back who are doing an incredible job to get us through this morning and enable us to meet with you, for Jesus to meet with you at home. So I just want to publicly thank them so much for their hard work in enabling this to happen. We have no congregation here because we're not allowed to at the moment, unfortunately. We'd love you all to be here with us, but that's not possible. But I just want to reassure you that those here this morning are those who are essential for this service to happen. So it's just us here who are able to be here this morning. A particularly warm welcome to you if it's your first time joining us, and well done for sticking with us through that. And as we meet this morning, there are going to be opportunities for us to join in at home with what's happening here. There'll be chances for us to speak out words and to sing together, and those words will appear on your screens at home. Last night, you may well have been a part of the Tear Fun Quiz that we did here at Holy Trinity, but was happening all across churches across the UK at the same time. And congratulations to the Telegraph Laners, who won that quiz with what was a near faultless performance, only missing out on one question through the whole quiz. That was incredible. Congratulations to them. The really great news, though, is that as a church community, we managed to raise over £1,600, which is wonderful. It all goes towards Tear Fund. And even better, that was part of a UK nationwide effort that raised nearly £170,000 as of this morning. So it's really amazing that we can be part of that initiative to be a blessing to our mission partner. I'm thrilled to say that Sarah Slater will be speaking to us on the prodigal son a little bit later on. It's a passage that many of us might be quite familiar with, but I'm really excited that Sarah is going to be bringing a fresh take on that passage to us this morning as we continue in our mission-shaped living series. We're going to begin our service again in a moment with some worship. But before we do that, why don't we let's just take a moment to still ourselves. It's been a chaotic morning for many of us, trying to get everything to work. But actually, we're all coming from different places, aren't we? Different weeks, different mornings. And we just want to remember why we're here. So, Jesus, we come before you this morning as our Saviour, as our Creator, as the author and perfecter of our faith. We come to you, no matter how our week has been, we come to you to give you our worship. Some of us may be struggling with lockdown. We might be feeling that acute sense of isolation in this time. We might be struggling in our family relationships or work relationships. Maybe we've been furloughed or made redundant. But whatever is going on in our lives, Jesus is Lord. He is Lord in this place. He is Lord over our lives. He is Lord over all things. And Jesus, we gather to give you glory. And we pray that as we praise you, you would bring change. You would bring transformation. You would bring life. You would bring hope. Come, Holy Spirit, as we give you the glory you deserve. Amen. Let's worship together.
As we're about to sing, the lyrics in the bridge of this song is, "Our weapon is a melody." And yeah, just as we are playing through the song, you can join us in singing if you're at home. Sadly, you can't in the building. But why don't you get somewhere nice and comfortable, whether it be standing, sitting, just join in with us and sing this over any stress or anxiety in your life right now. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. So I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Sing a little louder.
So we've just been singing about praising God in the middle of the storm. And the wonderful thing about that is that right now, although we know that it may feel like that for many of us at the moment, that we're in the storm, the wonderful thing is when we can praise God and we bring our praises to him, we declare that he is in control. He is sovereign and he is Lord. He reigns and he rules, and his word is the authority on all things. And when we bring our requests to him, he hears and answers. So that's what we're going to do now. We're going to bring our requests to him in prayer. The Houston family are going to lead us in this time. And at the end of the prayer, we're going to go straight into singing a hymn again, a wonderful hymn of praise to God. So I'm going to hand over to the Houston family to lead us in our prayers this morning.
Father, during this coronavirus pandemic, we lift up to you all those who are suffering with illness and pain. Please comfort and heal them and restore them to health and strength. In this time of distress and uncertainty, please be close to those who are anxious and fearful and sustain and support them. Comfort and console the bereaved and assure the lonely and isolated of your presence and love. May you be a light in their darkness, Lord, and may your spirit bring peace as we remember that nothing can separate us from your love as demonstrated to us in Jesus Christ. We pray for the skill, sympathy, and resilience of all those who are caring for the sick, and for your wisdom to those searching for and developing a vaccine. Amen.
Lord, we pray for the United States of America and the newly elected leaders in the White House, Senate, and Congress. We pray for the final months of President Trump's leadership and for President-elect Biden and Vice President-elect Harris as they prepare to take office in January and plan their policies and areas of focus and choose those who will serve with and support them during their term. We pray for a smooth and peaceful transition of power and ask that you inspire and guide these leaders and give them wisdom and discernment that they might do what is right. Please heal the divisions across the country, Lord. We pray for unification and for all sides to work together to uphold and protect human rights and justice for all America's citizens, regardless of race, class, gender, or religion. Amen.
With lockdowns happening across the globe, many of us will have faced restrictions on worship for the first time in our lives. Yet it is sobering to realise that many around the world have never enjoyed the same freedoms that until a few months ago we took so much for granted. As we mark the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church today, we pray for Christians around the world who are prevented from practising their faith and who are denied the freedom to worship you. We pray for the members of your church who continue to practise their faith despite fear of violence, arrest, imprisonment, torture, or worse. And we lift up to you those who sacrifice their jobs, their homes, and their freedom to follow and serve you. Lord, please protect all our suffering brothers and sisters today. Fill them with your strength, comfort, hope, and love. And we pray for a future where they can declare their faith with boldness and confidence. We give thanks for the work of our mission partner, CSW, who stands with all those facing injustice owing to their religion or beliefs. And we pray for the realization of their vision for everyone's freedom to believe. Amen.
Thanks for the staff team here at HTC and ask you to bless and support them as they continue to serve you and carry out your work under the current challenging circumstances and despite frequently changing safety parameters for both themselves and our church family. We thank you for their commitment to you and to all of us in working to enable our services and the groups that serve all sections of the congregation to continue, albeit remotely, so that we can still come together to praise and worshipify and glorify you and preserve our spiritual health. Despite face-to-face gatherings being prohibited, we give thanks, Lord, that your power surpasses any such restrictions and that we can take comfort in the knowledge that you are always with us. We pray that the staff team are filled and refreshed daily by your Holy Spirit, and for your guiding hand over them as they continue in your service this week and beyond. Amen.
We are now going to say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory is yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you so much to our worship teams, both on the worship band who's here today, but also the organists and all those singers who make our worship possible this morning. And I was going to, at this point, talk about how important our technology is in enabling people to meet with God at home. And I feel like that point's probably been amply demonstrated this morning. And actually, you know, we're in a season now where live streaming is probably here to stay one way or another, even when we come out of this. Actually, this is something we've invested in our equipment, and we want to be able to continue doing this, to meet with as many people as possible, even if they can't leave their homes. And to enable that to happen, the only way we can do it is to have a wonderful team of volunteers behind the scenes who are working away every single week. You know, things like the words on the screen, the sounds that you hear, the organists, the singers, the bands, it's only possible because the tech guys are here giving their time doing it. And actually, in terms of the guys who are behind the desk, the visual desk and the production and the sound, we've actually got quite small teams who are doing that. In some cases, it's been one or two people every single Sunday doing it for the past few months. And we just really want to bless them and give them a bit of a break and build in some resilience for them. So we'd love it if perhaps you're watching this morning and you're moved to get in touch and perhaps offer to help on this side. It doesn't have to be super advanced technology, but maybe you have got a background in broadcasting or streaming. Maybe you've worked on a sound desk or a mixing desk before. But even if it's just as simple as something, if you know how to use an iPad or a smartphone, you could really help us actually in this season. So we would love to hear from you. We're not asking for any commitment from you at this stage, but if you think you might be able to help, I'd love you to get in touch with me at my church email address. It's tomhill@htclaygate.org. I'd love to hear from you. So even though lockdown is here for a little longer, God is still at work among us as a community. And we're going to hear now about all the wonderful activity that is going on at Holy Trinity. So James is going to bring our notices. And then after that, we're going to move straight into our Bible passage for today, which Tabby is going to read. And then Sarah is going to come and share our word with us this morning.
Good morning. My name is James Hemper, and it is my pleasure to read out the notices for you this morning. But first, a little bit about me. I've been coming to HTC for the last 12 years since I moved into the area with my wife, CJ. We have two daughters, Grace and Lily, who go to secondary school near Guildford. CJ is a teacher at Isha Church School, and I work in the city for an investment management company. I grew up in a Christian family, and so I would probably consider myself to have been a Christian my whole life. Although, like most people, that journey hasn't always been smooth sailing. And there's certainly been times when I've wandered from the path and got a little lost. However, when things get tough, I always take comfort in remembering that I worship a great and glorious God. So I don't need to be in control, and I don't have to fear the future. And he is also a good and gracious Father who loves me and who wants the best for me. And this has been a particular comfort during these strange and uncertain times. So if you're struggling at the moment, take heart. God wants to meet up with you and lift you up. But now for our notices. Whilst there are no in-person services in church at the moment, we will be open every Wednesday from 12 noon until 2 p.m. for private prayer. If this time and day doesn't work with you, then please email the office at churchoffice@htcclaygate.org, and they will do their very best to open the church at a time that suits you. Next, planning is well underway for the coming Christmas season, and although some of the details are yet to be finalized, you might like to know that there will be two carol services this year. Plans are also in hand for crafts and carols to take place on Tuesday the 15th of December, and for beer and carols on Tuesday the 22nd of December. Both are needing careful and creative thinking about how we can make them work, given the restrictions, but we have a plan, and so watch this space. And finally, after the service today, there is an opportunity to catch up over coffee together on Zoom. The link was sent in yesterday's email, or access this information via the church website, and Janet Watkins will be there to welcome you. If you won the TFN Big Quiz last night, this might be your only opportunity to brag about it. So get on over there after the service. Now, over to Tabby Forbes, who will be bringing us our Bible reading for today.
Luke 15:11-32, the parable of the lost son. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set out for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way away, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the oldest son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has come back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found."
Welcome to you all from wherever you are joining us from. Let me just pray before we start. Lord, I just thank you for your word. Lord, I pray that you would reveal to each one of us today what you want us to see, hear, and how to respond to you in this passage. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you've been with us through this term, you'll know that we've been doing a sermon and study series on mission-shaped living. And this, I think, is where the rubber hits the road. Because through our studies, we have explored some quite simple steps to engage in mission-shaped living wherever we are. We've looked at how we can practically and prayerfully connect with others. We've looked at the importance of understanding their situation and having compassion for them. And hopefully, we've grown in confidence to take up Jesus' command to make disciples. But now we reach the crunch point, and it may be that it's where here, in the past, we've slammed on the brakes, when it actually comes to sharing the gospel message with those that we've connected with. It's at that point that we become a bit tongue-tied, when it actually comes to articulating what's at the very heart of the Christian faith. But we need to be ready for this moment. In 1 Peter 3, verse 15, it says this: "Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have." Or as the Message translation puts it, "Be ready to speak up and tell anyone who asks you why you're living the way you are." Thank you to Tabby for reading our passage to us today, the parable of the lost son. But what on earth has this got to do with telling others about how we live the way we do? Well, John McGinley describes this parable as a story of hope. And it's my prayer this morning that we find the hope in this story, both for ourselves and for those that we love and pray for who don't yet know the Lord. Because never has there been a more urgent need for a sense of hope in such an uncertain world. Now, I'm guessing that this parable is quite familiar to quite a few people. And so I want to take a different approach to exploring it today. Because so often when we come to a Bible passage, we sort of come with a magnifying glass. We explore it in depth, we examine the fine details, and then we consider its application to our lives. Today, though, I want us to bring two objects with us. Firstly, a backpack. So how can we take this passage from our participation in this service out into our everyday contexts to share the gospel with others? And secondly, a mirror. How can we see ourselves in this passage and the experience of the grace of our welcoming Father that we've had, and then take that out to share the gospel with others? How can we absorb this parable and be ready to use it in those God-given moments when somebody asks us, "So what do you believe?" So first, let's get our backpack at the ready. Now, I don't know if you've ever had to pack a backpack for a hike or a long walk, but if you have, you'll know that if you're going to carry it over a long distance or for a long time, you have to be really thoughtful about what you pack in it. And you only take those things that you will need to sustain and protect you on your adventure. Now, if I were packing my backpack for mission, this Bible passage would be in there, because it explains the gospel message perfectly and in such an engaging way. So it's called The Lost Son, but it's really about two lost sons, both walking away from their father in different ways. One wants to be free from his sonship and live the life that he wants to live, and one is mentally absent from his sonship, seeing himself really as a dutiful slave. But above all, it's a story of the abundant, reckless love of the father who is prepared to give away not only his possessions, but himself in order to rescue both sons. It's a story of unconditional love, repentance, forgiveness, and grace. And that's what makes it so essential in my mission backpack. It's the story of our faith. And it's what makes us live the way we do. So in the passage, the father loved both of his sons equally and their inheritance was assured. But the younger son chose to walk away from his father to live exactly how he wanted. He asked for his inheritance, and by doing so, he was effectively saying that he wished his father was dead now. But his father gave him what he wanted and endured the pain of watching his son walk away. Meanwhile, the elder son carried on at home dutifully. And the younger son reached the end of his inheritance and a realization about that life that he was living. He wasn't satisfied. He wasn't happy. He reflected and returned to his father asking for forgiveness. But before he could even get home, his father had seen him and was running towards him and lavished on him the finest that he had. And it's then that we see the lostness of the elder son. You see, he may well have been physically present in his father's house all that time, but there was no real love there, just a sense of duty. He had never loved his father for being his father, but for the things that he could get from him. One son was selfish, one son was self-righteous, but both were lost. But for both, there was no condemnation, just grace, the unmerited, unconditional love of the father. So that's their story. But it's ours too. God the Father loves us all unconditionally. We were made to be in relationship with him. But so often, we want to do our own thing. We might abandon God, or we might simply put him on the sideline. But either way, we sin. We put I in the middle. My will be done. But ultimately, that doesn't satisfy us or bring us happiness. And if we stop to reflect, the Holy Spirit convicts us of our selfish ways and draws us to the Father who's already running to us, and we repent. Now, that word repentance, at its simplest, simply means doing a 180. It's about turning away from a self-centered life to a life centered on God, just as the younger son did. And that life's only available to us through the sacrifice of the sinless Son, Jesus Christ, who left his inheritance in heaven to come to earth and give his life that we might be welcomed by God the Father running towards us. And in those embracing arms, there's no condemnation, just grace, the unmerited, unconditional love of the Father. Unconditional love, repentance, forgiveness, and grace. That's the essence of the lost sons, then and now. So this parable equips us to be missionaries, because all we really need to do is grasp that message for us and for all, and to be able to share it as simply as we can with others. So when we face that risk of being tongue-tied and unable to articulate our faith, can we just use these words of Jesus about the lost sons? Can we share their story to point people to our Heavenly Father, who longs to be in a relationship with us all? Can we get as comfortable with sharing a Bible story in the same way that we might share something we've read in the newspaper, an article, a feed on Instagram? Because after all, this story has stood the test of time for thousands of years, and it's not fake news. So, can we pack it and take it with us so that we are always prepared to have an answer for the reason for the hope that we have? But let's not just share their story. Let's share ours. And secondly, I want us to take a mirror and see where we fit into this parable. Because mission-shaped living is centered on relationship, getting to know people, understanding them, letting them get to know us. And it's in relationship that we will always be most comfortable sharing not just the faith, but our faith. I took a mirror to myself when I was preparing this talk, and I saw both the older and the younger son looking right back at me. This is what I saw. Now, I can't remember a time when I didn't go to church. It's just what we did as a family. But my faith at that point was a family faith. It wasn't really my faith. And all that changed at the age of 16. With some decent exam results to celebrate, I headed off on holiday with a group of girlfriends. And whilst away, we decided to take on some new identities. We changed our names. We had some careers. We added a few years on, which I find hilarious, because I certainly wouldn't be doing that now. And not surprisingly, we attracted the attention of a group of older men. In that identity, there was an opportunity to have a casual relationship that could have had a long-lasting, life-changing impact on my life. And that's where I see the younger son looking at me in the mirror. Something stopped me now. Was it a sense of responsibility to my parents? Was it a dose of common sense? I don't know, but I do know now it was God by His Spirit. And the following week, I was away on a Christian youth camp. And at the back end of that week, we were singing a worship song about the God who is able to keep us from falling and set us free from sin. At that moment, I knew I had been saved and protected that week before. Despite running away, I hadn't fallen. God had been there and had protected me. And now He was calling me. So I made that faith my own and decided to follow Jesus for myself. I ran into the Father's welcoming arms. And my faith journey continued throughout university, into married and working life. And although I knew how important God was in my life, I was still probably kind of fitting Him in around everything else. There was no rhythm to my relationship with God. But what I did do is serve on rotas. Rotas galore. I did anything and everything. And you know what? That's where the older son starts looking at me, right back in the mirror. But God came running for me again, 13 years ago, this time on the Growing Leaders course, which opened my eyes up to God's grace. Apologies for that slight pause. Let me just conclude. I was saying that we're now well-trained and leaving the house with hand sanitizer and with a face mask. And it didn't take long to form a habit because we knew that both were essential and potentially life-saving. So can we also become trained to have our 60-second story up our sleeve, to have the story of the lost sons in our backpack before we leave the house? because both of them are essential for kingdom building and have the potential to save lives for Christ in this uncertain time where stories of hope are needed more than ever. May we always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks us for the reason for the hope that we have, why we live the way we do. Backpack, a mirror at the ready. Amen.
Sarah, thank you so much for that really powerful word. That was incredible and something I think for all of us to take on board and just listen out for what the Spirit's saying to us through that message. And, you know, we've been battling a lot of technological issues this morning, and often, you know, that makes me think there's something really important that the Lord wants to speak to our hearts today. You know, the enemy often pushes back when the kingdom is advancing. So I just want to encourage us now to really rest with what Sarah has spoken to us this morning. There is power in the gospel. There is truth in the gospel. As Sarah said, it is not fake news. It is truth and is life-changing. And maybe there was something that stood out for you in what she brought to us. Perhaps you could identify with the younger son who'd been far off, distanced from God and living your own way. But it's not working and there's something missing. Maybe you feel a bit more like the older son, kind of weary and tired with life and trying to earn your way into the good books. Maybe you've lost heart or hope in the missional opportunities we have with the gospel, with the good news. Wherever we fall, whatever has been speaking to us this morning, there is an opportunity for us now to come back to God. However far away we are from him, however weary we've become, we have a chance to come back, just like the younger son. And we're going to do that now just by confessing our weaknesses and our flaws to the Lord, whatever they are. Doesn't matter how many times we've done this before. It could be the first time you've confessed anything to God. It could be the 5,000th time. We still need to do it. So let's just spend a moment just in quiet, thinking of those things from our week, but maybe even further back from the last few years of our life that we need to bring before the Lord this morning. We say together, Father, we have sinned against heaven and against you. We are not worthy to be called your children. We turn to you again. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to yourself as those who were once dead, but now have life through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins. Heal and strengthen us by his Spirit and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. So we're going to respond now to that word that we've heard. We're going to respond in the knowledge that we're forgiven, but also in the knowledge that we have this gospel, which is truth, that we can be confident through this parable that we've heard that God runs to us and he runs to those around us. We're going to sing about God's reckless love because of his passion to know us as his people. Let's worship.
Took a breath. still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Lord, we praise you for the truth of those words. There is no shadow you won't light up, no mountain you won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down. God, we praise you that your heart is for your people to know you, that you gave what was most costly to you to enable that to be possible. And we pray that as we go out into our week, that you would go with us, giving us the confidence of that message to take that gospel truth out to the people that we meet. Amen. Perhaps there's something this morning that's been particularly stirred in you as you've heard Sarah speak and as we've worshipped. It might be the first time that you've sensed the Lord moving in your life in that way. If so, I'd really encourage you to get in touch with us. You can reach us on prayer@htclaygate.org. So we'd love to hear from you. And wherever we are, all of us can take into our weeks the backpack and the mirror that Sarah's reminded us of this morning. So let's ask ourselves that question. Where is God taking us? Who is he bringing into our lives that he's calling us to communicate this message to afresh this week? As we finish, we're going to end with a blessing. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always, now and forever. Amen. Thank you so much for bearing with us this morning and sticking with us to the end. We'll continue wrestling with the technology, but thank you for your prayer and your worship and your presence this morning. God has been at work. Have a wonderful week.
There's life, there's healing.